off from under there.
Read some familiar scriptures to you.
just a moment and have prayer. Think about that night when they were in the upper room. Night before Jesus was crucified. We read this in Matthew 26:26. As they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it, broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." He took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and said, "Drink you all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, shed for many for the remission of sins." Precious Fathers, we pause tonight for a few minutes to think of the elements that will be taken to our body, representative of Christ's body. It was broken, whose blood was shed for us. Let us think deeply of the great price, the great sacrifice that he gave. And as we partake of the body, I pray, Lord, that we would be willing to surrender our all to you. As we partake of the blood as well, let us think about what you've done for us. Bless these elements we're about to partake of now. In Christ's name, we pray. Again, we read where Jesus took the bread and he broke it and he blessed it and gave it to the disciples. Again, quickly, Father, the body of Christ, bread so easily torn by our own hands, his body so easily broken by hate, envy, strife. They could care less how badly they bruised his precious body. Let us never forget what he's done for us as we partake of this bread this evening. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. these 12 disciples take him, he all prayed and represent the body of the world. Then Jesus took the chalice of wine and told them before he gave it to them, he blessed it and told them to drink all of it. Father, as we think of the juice we're about to drink, let us be reminded of Christ shedding his blood. His body was beaten and broken and bruised, but his blood represents his dying and his death. We thank you, Lord, he was willing to shed his blood for our sins. As we take this tonight, remind us afresh of his precious, sinless blood. In his dear name we pray. Paul tells us to remember his body, then remember his blood. Then he tells us, 1 Corinthians 11, to remember Calvary. He says, this do ye for the generations to come, for the 2,000 years to pass, until he comes again. So not only reflect back to Calvary, let the Holy Spirit guide your thoughts, think about what he did for us. But think forward to his coming. One day he's coming back. He's going to take his children home. He's going to give us new bodies, new family, new life. We have a lot to look forward to. So think about his goodness. As we partake of this juice that represents his blood that was shed for us.
told them to take and drink all of it, representing his blood that he will shed for you. Now, most of you know that when they got through, the Bible said they sang a song about the garden. We're going to sing Amazing Grace, but you're going to do something different tonight. We're going to sing the first and the last verses. We'll sing five verses. But there's actually eight verses to it, so I'll let you sing three verses that you've never sung before, unless you just not know the difference. So Brian's going to lead us in the song, but he'll be over here and go along with us. And he's a good man to be able to put the chairs on. Stand with us.
Thank you.
Spiritual, fleshly battle, he had a mental breakdown. It took him 2 years to get over his mental breakdown. During that time, he became a minister in a Baptist church up north. And he wrote this song, Peace in the Battle. Let me tell you when he wrote it. It was 1937. America had just come out of the Depression. Matter of fact, they were still in the Depression. And news was everywhere how Hitler was about to take over Europe. And he's on a train going through Indiana, and he's looking out at the cornfields and the valleys, and he comes across a valley, and he sees cattle, sheep, goats, and he thinks, why can't man live in peace? So he writes this song.
Where the moon is bright and the land is the light.
bless your hearts. You know, when you pull up the original words and then you pull up other words, they don't match. Did y'all see that? Well, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to bring you a message tonight that is actually the most read chapter in the Bible. Who knows what it is?
Psalms 23.
Now, most of the time when people read and preach from Psalms 23, it deals with comfort. But today, I want you to look at it from the standpoint of the promotion for those who follow the shepherd. The promotion for those who follow the shepherd. Let's pray. Father, thank you again that you love us. We pray you'll guide and direct as we look at your word and give us the strength and what we need today as we look at it and study it. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Many good men have given their opinions to what God's word says concerning this. Some people have given different time spans of when David may have written this. I personally believe that David wrote this towards the end of his life. I believe that it was written after David's youth, after David had slain the lion and the bear and conquered Goliath. I personally believe that it was written after David's great victories as a young man in the armies of Saul, where the women cried. Saul had killed his thousands, but David had killed his 10,000. I believe that it was written after Saul, in his heart, chased David through the Judean hillside, trying to take his life. I believe it was written after David had already become king of Israel and written many of the beautiful songs that we have today. I believe it was written after that dark spot in David's life where he committed that sin that called his enemies to blaspheme God. It was written, I believe, shortly after his son Absalom rose up against him and ran him out of his kingdom. And I believe that on that night or a few nights later, David sat under the lonely starry night. After David was exiled, after David no longer had his kingdom, after David no longer had his military arsenal, David possibly looked up to the heavens under those Judean hills. And while he's meditating on God's goodness and God's grace and God's greatness, he thinks and he writes this chapter. Verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. If you have your Bibles open, look at that progression. It goes from David being at the lowest point he could ever be, being at the bottom of a pit, and take him all the way to the palaces of heaven. It's a fantastic chapter to read and think and meditate upon. Now, I want to take these six verses, and we're not doing an in-depth study on them, but give you six simple thoughts that if you ever feel like you're in the pit, you'd be good to read these six verses and realize these six promotional thoughts. Number one is this: make God your shepherd. David said, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Again, think David is at the lowest place in his life. He's not in his palace. He's not sitting in his throne room. David is in some cave somewhere on the backside of a Judean hill,
hiding from his son that wants to take his life. And there in the Judean wilderness, when David may have thought he had lost everything he ever wanted, it dawned on him suddenly that he actually had everything he ever needed. He had the Lord. And not only did he have the Lord, he had so much more. He realized sitting there, as he thought back to the panoramic view of his life, God has been my shepherd all these days. And because David has spent those days and hours all his life meditating on God's word, he realized it paid off. In the good times, the bad times, the sunny days, the stormy days, as he meditated on his shepherd was leading him. And that meditation gave David peace, and at this very low point in his life, it promotes David from the pit to soon he'll sit upon his throne again. Wow, the Bible is like a crystal clear pool of water. The more you meditate on the scriptures, the more clearly you see what is below the surface. And a lot of people that just read it, they just see what's on top. But as they meditate, they see deeper and deeper and deeper into God's word. Many people choose to swim in their own dirty little swimming pools of sin. But oh, if we'd ever learn to swim in the beautiful, crystal clear pools of God, how refreshing and how stimulating and how invigorating God's word is to our soul. If you ever think, you know, preach, I'm a Christian, but I just don't have a whole lot of joy again. Follow the shepherd. Put him first in your life. Now, we are sheep. And John tells us this about sheep. My sheep hear my voice. And I know them. They follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. If you just look at those two verses there, if you ever study the manner of sheep, you know that basically they're not very intelligent. Now, God calls us sheep. Now, what that means is we need to be humble. We don't need to think we know it all or know anything at all. We must follow our shepherd, and if we will let him lead, here's some good character traits about sheep. They know the shepherd's voice. Number two, they follow the shepherd's direction. Number three, they know the shepherd is there to lead them into refreshment. Number four, the shepherd's presence gives them security. They shall never perish. And I like this fifth one. The sheep know as long as they stay near the shepherd, nothing can hurt them. Oh, precious friend, make the Lord your shepherd. Don't just say it. Make him your shepherd. Spend time with him. So, we see what the Lord does for David if he makes him his shepherd. Make him your shepherd, you're fixing to go up. The second thing, we see David's satisfaction. What do you want in life? David said, when I didn't have anything, I realized I didn't want anything. If I had my Lord and my God, I had the greatest thing there was. As a whole, sheep are very content creatures. Did you know that? David lost everything that night in the Judean hillside. He lost his mighty military. He lost his awesome arsenal. But he realized he had all he really needed with his faith in God. He realized he came to the place God had always wanted him to come. He wanted David to come to the end of himself. And I'll tell you this, if life is a struggle for you, if you're unhappy more than you are happy, God is trying to bring you down to the pit so that he might lift you up to the palace. He has to humble us before he can lift us up. We must have a cross and a crown of thorns before we can ever have the crown of gold. Look at verse 2 as David talks about the satisfaction he found in the Lord. He said, "He, God, maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters." What will God have to do to get you to come to the end of yourself where you'll lie down and graze in his pastures? Remember, sheep eat the grass, but they don't just eat it. A lot of us have devotionals. We read the scripture, but that's not enough. A sheep would die if all it did was eat the grass. But he swallows the grass into his formation, and he regurgitates it back up. He spits out the stones, and he spits out the stick, and then he chews his cud all morning long. A sheep cannot live on grass. When that grass goes into the fourth chamber of his stomach, the protozoans eat that grass. They turn into a meat product, and the sheep digest the meat. And that's how they live, and that's how you and I live. Just reading the scriptures, just letting it go through our mind, does not give us energy. It does not give us strength. We have to meditate on it to digest it. When I was a boy, we worked hard all day on the farm. There's nothing quite as refreshing as a dive into a refreshing body of water. Maybe your work, maybe people you hang around at your work, maybe finances or circumstances have stressed you to the kilt. May I suggest you do something? Let God lead you to some still waters. Can you picture yourself out there fishing, sitting out there on that morning as the fog has come off the lake, everything's quiet, and you're just casting out that reel? You don't care if you catch anything. When we come to the place, we say, "God, I'm just going to cast in your word, and I'm just going to think about your precious word." Oh, the world goes, go, 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 run, 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 get, grab, 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 hurry, hurry, hurry. God says, "Be still and know that I am God." Thus, sheep of God, I admonish you, take time for the shepherd. Did you notice in Psalms 23:2 the word maketh? Did you notice that? Maketh. I told you sheep aren't too intelligent. Sometimes God says, "Hey, sit at my feet. Hey, seek my face. Hey, study my word. Hey, love me." And sometimes it doesn't sink in. And so God leads us in life as a good father would lead a child. You that have had sons or daughters know that when they were young and you would go out to the yard to work, and pick the weeds out of your garden, they wanted to help. They would pick the flowers. But they wanted to be there with you. You wanted to cut the grass, and your little boy wanted to help you cut the grass. And then for some reason, they came to that age where they figured out that's work. And they said, "Daddy, I want to go in and watch TV." And a good daddy said, "Oh, no, son. Life is about work, not play. We'll help Daddy outside. I love you. We'll have fun together. You're going to learn to work." Now what happened if that little boy said, "Well, Daddy, I'm just not going to do it." Well, a good daddy will compel his child to obey. You know what I mean by that? A good daddy will compel his child to obey. God's like that. God loves us. And boy, we first get saved and we're reading the Bible and we're going to church and we're praying and boy, life is so good. And then the devil tells us it's work. He says, "Play. Live in your flesh. Have fun. Do your thing." And God says, "No, listen. This is a war. I need you to abide. I need you to chew the cud. I need you to go down by the pastures and lie down. I need you to go by the river and drink some fresh water. Well, I'm not going to do it, God. And then God makes us. God made David lie down. God's never mean. God will never spank you with a stick. But he will let circumstances come into our lives that will tell us to slow down in life. Won't you let the shepherd lead you and be still and know that he is God? I'm getting up a busload of Dobie's legs tonight after church. Got some fishing poles and a bus. We'll just head out and do some fishing. All right, wouldn't that be good? We've done that. When I was in Florida, we used to go out and fish all night, swim in lakes without a kid. That's another message. Okay. Thirdly, you see David's strength in verse 3. I like this. Now, where did we start? We recognize he was our shepherd. We're laying down in his pasture. We're eating from his word. We're drinking water from his spirit. Man, we're getting stronger. You see the promotion? And what happens as we get stronger? He restoreth my soul. Boy, you can't do it by yourself. You can't say, I'm going to get strong spiritually. It doesn't work that way. We must abide in his word. And as we abide in his word, he restores our soul. How many of you ever had a fender bender? You know, fender in. I've had a number of them, most of them in my own driveway. Don't park behind me if you come to my house. My phone rings as an emergency. I forget you're behind me. I have a tendency to back out and hit you. This costs me too much money. One time in 1975, this was a sweetheart, we were in Chattanooga, Tennessee, in that nice trailer, you know? And it was a bad curve. And you got ready to pull out of the dirt driveway, you had to kick it. And my wife kicked it one day, and another guy came around that curve pretty fast, caught the back end of the car. And the policeman called the state trooper, and he said, well, seeing that he may have been speeding, seeing that seeing that you both have the same insurance company, we'll let you pay for your to get fixed. Well, being at where I was at that time in my life, you can only afford liability insurance. So it was going to cost about $300 to get that fender fixed, and I didn't have it. So I decided to just bondo it myself. Now that's not actually the car. But had you seen the bondo job that I did on that car? It was so bad it would have made a blind man frown. I mean, you could really tell that's ugly. But one day, a man at the church where we were working at asked me to borrow my car one day, and I said, sure. He said, I want to fix this on it, turn into something else on the car. And he took it home. He was a mechanic. And he fixed that baby for nothing. Brought it back to me. Hey, I said, that was good. If you just give him what he already owned, he'll fix you again. He'll restore you back to that day where your life was filled with love and joy and peace. That's what God means when he says he restoreth our soul. So think about it. Verse 1, we're lowly. Verse number 2, we lie down in green pasture. In verse number 2, verse 3, he restoreth our soul. And when God does those three things, what's the next thing he does? When he restores our soul, you know that he's going to lead you in the paths of righteousness. You always know when a Christian has made things right with God because now the Lord is going to lead us to do right. Jesus' job is to restore in my life whatever I am missing. If I need love, he loves me. He leads me to lie down in green pastures. When I'm down, he picks me up. When I'm discouraged, he encourages me. When I have a need, he gives me that shot of caffeine that I need, right, Charlie? The pick-me-up to get. Or that energy drink, young people, to keep you going, you know, when you're tired. When I'm lonely, he's my friend. When I'm lost, he becomes my compass. When I feel discouraged, he becomes my encouragement. He'll always restore you if you'll let him lead you by the still waters. And if you'll lie down in the green pastures of his word. Now, David's getting closer and closer to God. God's picking him up. His spirit's being promoted. And when you come to verse 4, you see David recognizes his safety net. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Hey, a lot of people are afraid of death. A lot of people don't like to talk about death. But David here says, have you ever been frightened by a shadow? How many of you know that a shadow can't hurt you? How many of you know that? I know some of you say, preacher, a shadow can make you hurt yourself. So that's how some people think, you know. But a shadow can't hurt you. And the Holy Spirit leads David to give us this tremendous verse so that we never have to fear death, because Jesus Christ tasted death for us. And Paul wrote, after Jesus tasted death for us, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? When you and I die, all we see is the shadow of death. It's all we see. And God says, I'll give you grace at that time. And then we take our last breath down here. We take our first breath in the presence of the Lord's glory. And that's it. But oh, have you ever thought about the sinner that knows not Christ when they die? Oh, they die down here. And then they open their eyes in hell. And they hear the screams of the damned, the gnashing of the teeth. They feel the fires of hell. And they realize there is a God. And I made a terrible mistake. And now they know that they will be lost for all eternity. And that death, that eternal death for them has just begun. Wow. I'm glad I have a shepherd to lead me. How about you? Amen. Well, if you look at that verse again, David also says, thy rod and thy staff comfort me. Now, I have to scratch my head on that a little bit. How can a rod bring comfort? That rod was used to discipline. We say, preacher, I can understand the staff. You see, the crook on the staff was used sometimes by the shepherd if the sheep went astray, to reach and grab them and pull them out of a pit, or to bring them closer to him if they got off the path. And the Lord does that. He calls us to come and get closer to him all the time. But the rod is for disciplining. The rod is for chastening. To preach, I don't like that. Oh, yes, you do. Because if you don't belong to him, he won't chasten you. And the reason the Lord chastens us, because like a sheep that doesn't know any better, if we wander off too far from the fold, the lions and the wolves and the serpents can take our life. And the poisonous plants that the shepherd goes into the field before the sheep and plucks them out. He does all of that for us. The shepherd does not use his rod because he hates us, but because he loves us and he knows what is best for us. I've told the story many times before. I'll tell it to you again. Normally, if a sheep goes astray, the shepherd will call his name, James! Come on back. You're too far back there, James. Love James? Oh, that's the preacher. That's the Lord. I'll just keep on going. He'll take up a rock and a sling. He'll take that sling and he won't hit James with it. He'll throw it on the other side to startle him. Sometimes someone in your life might get ill, sick, or even worse. And that's to wake us up. Hey, go back to the shepherd. Buffy still goes his way. The shepherd will go in compelling to come back into the fold. But the sheep continues to go astray. The shepherd in love will take that sheep and break his front leg so it can't walk. Men did put the little lamb around its neck and carry it for the next couple of weeks so the lamb can get used to the voice of the shepherd. You know what's dangerous today? I knew that story for 30 years. As it used to be that when something happened to someone that was tragic, they would go back to the scriptures and read the scriptures and they would seek God and give. But now, when tragedy comes to the average person's life, they lay on the couch and watch television all day. No devil's good, isn't it? Rather than seeking the Lord again, we just fill our mind with other things rather than Him. Wow. If you will notice, lastly, well, sheep are defenseless. You say, preacher, what does that mean? I can handle myself. See, that's your pride. You can't handle yourself. Sheep are defenseless. They have no weapons. They don't have claws. They don't have teeth to bite with. And they're not supposed to. The shepherd is supposed to take care of them. They're supposed to stay close to the shepherd. The shepherd is their defense. They're not supposed to run because their body temperature is already 103 degrees. And if they run too far, they'll die of a heart attack. So they're supposed to just stay close to the shepherd. They're not to go away. So David's learning all of this. And he's writing it down because he spent so much time meditating on God's word. And then fifthly, David says, God's my supplier. That sounds strange today, doesn't it? You know, with this drug crazy culture, who's your supplier? But folks, God's my supplier. He gives me all the highs I need. And He'll give you all the highs you need. God said, I prepared a table for you in the presence of your enemies. God says, I'll supply your every need if you will just trust me. And David, I think, is thinking, when I was chased by Saul in the wilderness, God supplied me a cave to hide in. When David says, I was run out of my kingdom, God has supplied me shelter. When David was knocked down, almost defeated by one of Goliath's brothers, God sent someone to support him and supply their need for David. And I'm glad as believers in Jesus Christ, we have one who will supply a table for us in the wilderness. And He'll say to us, when things aren't going as we think they should, come and dine. The Master calleth. Come and dine. You see, the disciples on the sea that morning after Jesus rose again, they were fishing. Wasn't doing too good at that. Business wasn't the way it used to be. Things just weren't going well. Yet, the Lord was saying, come and dine. How's business for you these days? How's life going for you these days? How's your joy level? How's your peace level? How's your love level? Well, you say, preacher, it could get better. Can I give you some advice? Come and dine with the Master. Just come and dine. Ah, how the Lord is good to us. Notice again at God's table, He also protects us from our enemies. Did you see that? At God's table, we dress in armor. And we are anointed by His Spirit as well. Remember Ephesians 6? We eat of God's grace. We dress in His spiritual armor. And then we're told to walk in the Spirit or be filled with the Spirit. And when we do that, we do it for this big reason. We're fighting a war. A war we can't not win by ourselves, but a war we can win if we will follow our shepherd. And then towards the end of that verse, he talks about my head has been anointed with oil and my cup runneth over. You say, preacher, what is that referring to? You and I get older in life. We think about it won't be much longer, Jay. Johnny. I had a birthday today. This will be Johnny's last year in his 60s. It's not scary. It's not frightening. Some of the young people look at some of those old folks and say, I don't want to get that old. Well, you've got two alternatives. You're either going to get this old, you're going to die first, or the other. But the Lord says, I anoint you, I'll comfort you, I'll take care of you. I'm glad he does. You say, preacher, do you wish you could live your life all over again? No. Would you like to be a teenager again in the year 2017? No. I feel sorry for you that are teenagers. But there's no sick one out there, don't you? I have 1,000 times the freedoms you have. There's sin, like there's sin on every street corner in this crazy world. Boy, I'm glad that I'm as old as I am. The Lord took me home tonight. I wasn't fine. I just want to get home, eat my blueberry pancake first. You know? If I don't make it, it'll be okay. Maybe I'll have blueberry pancakes at the marriage supper. Just have to wait and see. Well, the last call is this. I like this. This is David's story. If you could sum up your life, how would you sum it up? Paul said, I fought the fight. I kept the faith. I finished the course. If you had to sum up your life today because you were going to die tomorrow, what would you say? I thought about that. I thought about this. I've never seen God's people taking breath. I've never in my life, though there's been times I didn't know where the next penny was coming, God's always taken care of me. I can tell you, and my wife and I talk about this, that when I first got saved, and if I had I planned out my life rather than seek first the kingdom of God, and that's what we decided to do, to seek first the kingdom of God, had I planned out my life, I could not have had the blessings that I've experienced, because God does a much better job than you can ever do in planning out your own life. Just say, God, hey, I will be content wherever you put me in life. Look at David's story. Panorama. He's looking back. He's looking forward. He says, surely, or truly, God's goodness, God's mercy has followed me all the days of my life. And I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Well, I'm looking forward to that. I mean, I can look back, and you can do one or two things when you look back in your life. You can look at the bad times, or you can look at the good times. To me, the good times are only good because you see where God brought you from. So I thank God for those times of struggle, so that when we hit those hills, isn't this nice? In the valley. Oh, then he goes, isn't this nice? Hey, if you lived on the mountain all the time, you wouldn't be any good. Remember, at 11,500 feet, no trees grow. So God keeps us where he keeps us so that we can be led to lie down in the green pastures and led by the still waters so that we might enjoy his. Hey, the Lord's a good shepherd. My challenge to you, don't get ahead of him. Follow his word. Slow down. Be still and know that he is God. Be content where you are. Godliness with contentment is great gain, because one day you and I are heading to Beulah. Penny, are you going to sing that for me? We ever get that down? Kathy's going to sing. Okay, I didn't know if Penny was or not. Kathy's going to sing that for me. I want them to sing Dual Land. I haven't heard it in about 2 years, and I'd just like for you to enjoy it. If y'all would like to help Kathy on this, we're going to put the words up here. You can read them and think about these words. Many of you know Squire Parson wrote it, and it's a beautiful song. God bless Squire. In fact, he used to tell the story just so a school teacher. God gave him the voice to sing, developed it. God made him write many beautiful songs. Enjoy this as we think about going home.
Thank you for your precious word that does
excite us and lift us up and encourage us. I pray you'll always be our shepherd. I pray we'll always follow your word. I pray, God, you will bless your people here in a great way as they abide with you. May we be good sheep as we follow our shepherd. In Christ Jesus' precious name we pray.